throughout its storied history, many in the pro wrestling business have spoken about the importance of creating big moments in order to leave a legacy within the annals of sports entertainment folklore. In the WWE, the largest pro wrestling company in the world, this idea on the significance of big moments is particularly key to the company's presentation. Throughout the last 50 years, countless stars have entered the ever-evolving world of the WWE. In that time, many men have caught the attention of the fans with their ability to create these larger-than-life moments. Fewer men have turned that attention into a career and through years of hard work and exceptional levels of talent, become legends. Fewer still have achieved what the man who is the topic of this video today has achieved. Over a career spanning 5 decades, The Undertaker managed to capture the hearts of audiences around the world in a way which no other performer in the entire history of pro wrestling. I want to dig deeper into the exact components which The Undertaker brought together, which revolutionized the way in which the entire sport is presented in the current day. From his electrifying entrance, his ever-changing personas, and his iconic moveset, I'm going to explore the man outside of the ring, behind the curtain, and at home, to better understand just what it takes to live such an unusual and extraordinary life. From his family, his friends, and his enemies within the pro wrestling business. Finally, I'll aim to bring all of this together and create a complete picture of the dead man, the phenom, the American badass, Mark Calaway, The Undertaker. In the worlds of sports and entertainment, we so often see that those who are considered to be world class, the top of their league, have shown huge potential and a great affinity for their chosen activity from an incredibly young age. Whether it be Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart and his famous musical compositions created from the age of 3, Pablo Picasso's innate ability to draw before he uttered his first words, Serena Williams became a pro tennis player at just 13 years of age and hasn't slowed down since. Born Mark William Calaway in Houston, Texas on March 24, 1965, The Undertaker's beginnings saw him excel in sports due to his love for the training and competition, and also, in no small part, due to his enormous stature. He loomed over children of the same age and dominated on both the American football field and the basketball court whilst he attended Waltrip High School through his teens. The youngest child to 4 older brothers, Mark Calaway not only had a naturally large frame, but had from a young age constantly engaged in play fighting and competitive hobbies with his siblings. This certainly fed into his ability to use his size and power and help toughen the young man, preparing him for his future career. When Mark Calaway graduated in 1983, he immediately gained a scholarship for basketball at Angelina College in Lufkin, Texas, where he continued to excel in his physical achievements and gained the attention of the scouts at Texas Wesleyan University in Fort Worth, where he studied sports management alongside his on-court activities. It was in 1985 when Mark Calaway was selected to play for the Texas Wesleyan Rams, the basketball team, playing with them through the 85 and 86 season, but not managing to dominate on the court as he once had, partly due to the natural way in which now his competition had been refined. Most of them were now as tall as him, if not taller. Just like most young people at that age, we're all in a constant state of flux. From our ever-changing hormones leading to more erratic emotional changes, deciding on our hopes and expectations of the future, and beginning on a path that may be the start of a lifelong career. As we look back, it's easy to say that Mark Calaway made the perfect decision in turning away from basketball and lacing up his wrestling boots, but at that time, the future was still unknown for the man that would become The Undertaker. It's fair to say that in 1986, as Mark Calaway was beginning to search for someone to train him in the art of pro wrestling, that the industry was enamoured with larger-than-life action, larger-than-life personalities, and most importantly, larger-than-life physiques. At this time, Mark Calaway was lucky enough in that regard to have grown to be 6'8" with a well-built frame. His past in basketball meant he was considerably quicker than most his size, and certainly more agile. When he walked into the gym of Buzz Sawyer in 1986, Mark Calaway was disappointed to be met by a sense of disinterest and what he would later refer to as a lack of commitment. Nevertheless, He put in the effort to get into even better physical shape and absorbed the limited education provided to him by Buzz Sawyer. During his time at WCCW, that Mark Calaway met and befriended Don Jardine, known in ring as the Spoiler. Jardine had perfected a move whereby he grabbed an opponent into a wrist lock, then climbed up onto the top rope. He taught the move to Calaway. The Undertaker has used this move in most of his matches throughout his entire career, and yes, in a sense of realism, it is a little bit of a stretch, but in pro wrestling, it has become an iconic part of the Undertaker's old school moveset.
Calls himself Master of Pain.
By 1988, Calaway had moved to the Continental Wrestling Association and began to make more influential connections within the company. The most important of which, Dutch Mantel, would be Calaway's manager in his first match for the CWA. Coming to the ring as the Master of Pain, we heard tales of this man's past before he became a wrestler. The Master of Pain had supposedly earned his moniker after leaving the United States Penitentiary, serving 5 years in solitary confinement for killing two men in a fistfight. This aura surrounding the new arrival only grew when, following the Master of Pain's second match, he refused to leave the ring and instead put out a challenge to the then holder of the USWA Unified World Heavyweight Championship, Jerry Lawler. To be so bold, so confident in your abilities, as a relative newcomer to the wrestling industry, it shows how Mark Calaway has, from an incredibly early stage in his career, been allowed to step beyond the usual boundaries as someone with his lack of experience. Jerry Lawler couldn't be seen to be afraid of this unknown entity and thus made his way to the ring, where he offered to prove his worth in a match, to begin immediately. Looking back, with the size difference between the two and the success that Calaway would have over the following 3 decades, it's not really a surprise that the Master of Pain took control of Lawler and dominated him throughout the pair's first brief encounter. One which was cut short when Dutch Mantel stepped in and stopped the onslaught. By April the 1st, the Master of Pain had declared himself number one contender and displayed his power over the current champion, enough to earn himself a legitimate title shot. In a career whereby The Undertaker has continually defied the odds and gone against the pre-existing script of how pro wrestling was presented, this was something of a genesis moment. In his first title match in his career, the Master of Pain beat Jerry Lawler and won his first championship belt. It may not have been the longest run in his career, Calaway would drop the belt just 3 weeks later back to Jerry Lawler, but regardless, the victory gave Calaway the taste for success and would later set the tone for the rest of his career. After losing his championship match, Calaway was rebranded and represented as the Punisher, with little backstory and a slightly different look, but the same dominating demeanour we've grown accustomed to from The Undertaker over the years. On October the 5th, 1989, Eric Embry was forced to forfeit the WCWA Texas Heavyweight Championship, and it was handed to the Punisher without contest. However, he would never lose the belt before late 1989, when he would make the first big move of his career.
Mean Mark Callis!
Mark Calaway's stock continued to rise as he joined World Championship Wrestling at the end of 1989, where, under the advice of Terry Funk, created the character Mean Mark Callis. Mean Mark came to the ring in WCW wearing mostly black with a more dark edge to his persona. Jim Ross explains to us on commentary that Mean Mark Callis has a keen interest in snakes and regularly listens to such demonic music as Black Sabbath, which by today's standards neither indicates that someone's a villain nor that they're in any way affiliated with the dark side of the occult. But back then, you can see why this type of characterization existed. When Sid Vicious was injured, his tag team, the Skyscrapers, were left one man giant short. On January the 3rd, 1990, Mean Mark Callis was paired with Dan Spivey to form a new version of the Skyscrapers as the two men took on Randy Harris and Agent Steel in Mark's debut for WCW. At the Clash of Champions 10 event, the Skyscrapers attacked the tag team champions after their match. The infamous Road Warriors responded by demanding a Chicago street fight match at the upcoming Wrestle War pay-per-view. Just days before the event, Dan Spivey left WCW and Mean Mark with little warning, leaving the Skyscrapers yet again a man short. This time, an masked wrestler joined Mean Mark in the ring and the pair promptly got defeated by the Road Warriors, leaving no option but for the Skyscrapers to officially disband not long after. As Mark Calaway yet again reassessed his position within the company, he took strides towards further success in his singles career. Paulie dangerously soon became a mentor of sorts to Mean Mark Callis as a character and Mark Calaway as a man. Callis's single run was off to a better start than before, with wins against Johnny Ace at Capital Combat and Brian Pillman at Clash of Champions 11. Callis was starting to become much more comfortable in front of the crowds and cameras as his confidence grew. At this time, Calaway travelled to Japan in order to better improve his in-ring ability and grappling technique. Although incredibly brief, for the few matches he wrestled during his time, Calaway went under yet another in-ring name of The Punisher Dice Morgan. One man who did not see the potential in Calaway was WCW legend Ole Anderson, who, during a contract negotiation, told Calaway that nobody would ever want to pay to see you wrestle. Understandably, Mark Calaway had spoken out since about how this affected his stability within the company and pushed to seek a future elsewhere. At the Great American Bash in 1990, Calaway's opportunity came. The word had gotten to him before the event that none other than Vince McMahon, the head of WCW's biggest rivals, the World Wrestling Federation, was considering signing him and would be scouting him on television during the match that night. According to Bruce Pritchard, feelers had already been sent out to the WWF by Heyman. McMahon initially did not express interest, but encouraged him to speak with Calaway when WCW travelled to New Jersey. Calaway knew when he laced up his boots that day that he had to do everything he could to impress, and went out to have a hard-fought NWA US Championship match against Lex Luger. In a horrible turn of events, Calaway dislocated his hip and must have been in blinding pain. Nonetheless, showing that in the wrestling industry you have to be a little bit mad to succeed, wrestled to the finish of the match with his hip completely out of its joint, something which is said to have impressed Vince McMahon. After the match, the deal was agreed in principle and Mark Calaway handed in his notice to leave WCW on August 27th. At this point, Calaway had travelled around the country to Japan and back. He had gained a better understanding of the inner workings of the industry from those who came before him. He had made great friendships which would last until this very day, and most importantly, he had refined his performance skills in a way which would create the foundations for one of the most outstanding and important careers in all of sports entertainment. Thousands have travelled from around the world to see one man. The crowd is ready to experience in real life what millions of us have witnessed and been in awe of for most of our lives. A special occasion in entertainment which, but for a brief moment, allows us to escape the humdrum realities of this mortal realm and take a journey into the valley of death with a man who holds the keys to the place. As the lights in the arena fade to black, the atmosphere changes. We're no longer surrounded by countless strangers in a sea of faces we'll never ever recognise. In the darkness, we're all drawn together by our love of this unusual form of entertainment and sucked in by the spectacle of what we're about to witness. Literal, metaphorical electricity fills the air. Zaps of lightning flash across the room, their speed somewhat misleading, their urgency a certain juxtaposition to the methodical nature of what we are now a part of. A bell tolls. If anyone had any doubt that this was real, children are visibly scared now as adults crank their neck to try and get a better look. Still, some in disbelief. Could it really be him? The third sound of bells rings out, and the fans have no doubt. He's here. Smoke begins to bellow and obscure the view of the cameras and the fans. The human mind is scared of what it doesn't understand. There's a reason that you get a chill when you're alone in the dark. And even whilst rubbing shoulders with numerous fans around you, somehow, you feel like it's just you and the dead man. The smoke clears slightly. The lighting in the stadium continues to fill the clouds with vibrant purples and electrifying bolts of blue. The crowd is a mixture of shock and excitement. Many cover their mouths as gasps escape into the atmosphere of the night. Some cannot contain themselves and fill the room with chants and support for their wrestling idol. A storm continues to brew, and as the clouds crash together and flames shoot into the air above, fans are on the edge of their seat. They explode and can barely believe their eyes. A childhood hero, an icon, is within their sights. A huge dark figure stands shrouded in smoke, cloaked in the mystery which was built around his persona for generations. A mythical apparition, appearing just like the smoke, his presence fills the arena in exactly the same way. Still and silent, the man is unwavering in his focus, journey. One more step, and another. We see no posturing, but don't let that fool you. These moments are small masterpieces of showmanship and presentation, letting them know that this isn't an ordinary fight inside of a wrestling ring. The darkened man bringing with him not only his army of fans in attendance or the decades of experience, but also the emotional and psychological control in which he imposes on his enemies. And it works. The long road, which has got us here, perfectly reflected by the distance between the entrance to the ring, which now we watch The Undertaker cover at his own pace, taking complete control of everybody's attention. His long arms hanging his gigantic hands by his sides, his emotionless face showing no signs that this spectacle has any effect on him. This show is to intimidate his opposition and get inside of their heads. Why would The Undertaker be anything but calm whilst in the middle of doing the one thing that he is better than anybody else in the world at? Now, the atmosphere is thick with smoke hanging in the air. Crackles and sparks still alight the fog, and through it, The Undertaker nears the ring. The orchestra swells in unison with the emotion, and as he continues his slow walk up the steps, like an old battle-hardened general, this is the moment that The Undertaker allows himself to survey the opposition, looking directly into their eyes for the first time, seeking out some sort of truth behind their shielded expressions as a huge storm erupts over the ring and solidifies the fact that death is amongst us. With respect and love, the dead man enters the ring, one hand on his hat, his other now back at his side. The music is blown into a frenzy, and nobody can take any more of this tension. A brief pause lets us know that The Undertaker is still fully in control. A deep breath shows us his composure. His hand begins to slowly remove his large black hat, and as it passes his weathered and worn face, the lights in the room are brought back up to reveal the eyes of a demonic deity, as The Undertaker's pupils roll back inside of his head. A terrifying, poignant, and iconic moment, followed by the final swell of the crowd as the atmosphere becomes less about the theatre and artistry and more about the war that is coming. The Undertaker, now in his mortal form, stares his eyes like daggers through his opponent and brings a thumb to his throat. Soon, his enemies will be a dead man, just like him. 4 minutes and 20 seconds, the seventh match on the card. No build and minimal storyline going into the match, who was happy to help establish a new star in the industry at the time. As the evening rolled on to the next match, The Ultimate Warrior versus Macho Man Randy Savage, The Undertaker's first WrestleMania victory disappeared without any fanfare. Little did we know that we had just witnessed the start of what would become known as the greatest winning streak in all of sports entertainment. In the months leading up to WrestleMania 8, The Undertaker had formed an alliance with Jake the Snake Roberts, the two men drawn together by their penchant for the psychology of a wrestling match and their desire to spread evil amongst the roster. In February, Jake Roberts attacked Macho Man Randy Savage and Miss Elizabeth on Saturday night's main event. A few weeks later, on a funeral parlour segment, when Jake Roberts asked The Undertaker whose side he was on, the dead man famously replied, "Not yours." And the match for WrestleMania was set. During the bout in the Hoosier Dome in Indiana, and delivered a brutal tombstone piledriver outside the ring, rolled Roberts' body into the ring and earned his second WrestleMania victory in 6.5 minutes. By 1993, The Undertaker was embroiled in a feud with manager Harvey Wimpleman. Each week, The Undertaker would become enraged at Wimpleman and attempt an attack only to be presented by one of Wimpleman's proxies. Each week, The Undertaker would destroy these wrestlers in an attempt to get his hands on his new nemesis. When the Royal Rumble came around, Harvey Wimpleman had one last trick up his sleeve. During the match, he introduced Giant Gonzalez, an enormous man who was presented as a literal animalistic giant, but who was in fact just a large person in a hairy, muscular onesie. Regardless, the size of the giant was clear for all to see, and his plan, instigated by Wimpleman, was devilish too. Giant Gonzalez eliminated The Undertaker during the Royal Rumble with the knowledge that he would certainly get a chance to face the dead man at the upcoming WrestleMania event. As these two man mountains came face to face in Las Vegas for WrestleMania 9, the match was over before it began, Giant Gonzalez decided not to use his strength and size to win the match, but for some unexplained reason brought a rag with chloroform soaked into it to the ring and attempted to suffocate The Undertaker. Gonzalez was immediately disqualified for his actions, and the match fizzled out, earning The Undertaker his third WrestleMania victory. When The Undertaker suffered his first big injury of his WWF career in 1994, he was unable to compete throughout most of the year. He was quickly becoming one of the company's bigger stars, and Vince McMahon didn't want a character which he'd put so much screen time on to be forgotten by the fans. Thus, the imposter Undertaker was born, managed by the Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase, and was brought in as a surrogate. Upon the return of the real Undertaker, the two versions faced off as the real Undertaker tried to get at the mastermind of the plot to replace him, DiBiase. When The Undertaker defeated this poor imitation, Ted DiBiase sent his best man in to finish the job. At WrestleMania in 1995, the human thumb King Kong Bundy represented DiBiase in a match against The Undertaker, one which saw the giant Bundy slammed off his feet before receiving a jumping clothesline from the Deadman and the 1-2-3. During the Royal Rumble pay-per-view in 1996, The Undertaker had a match against the WWF Champion Bret Hart for the belt and was seemingly in a position to win the WWF Championship. Only the hand-grabbing Mack Truck Diesel had other ideas. When Big Daddy D interjected and cost The Undertaker the match, the Dead Man was set on revenge. At In Your House, Rage in the Cage, karma bit back as The Undertaker caused Diesel to lose in his very own title match. This bad blood led to a match at WrestleMania 12 in California, where the two man mountains collided in a slow and methodical 16-minute match, one which saw The Undertaker capture the victory after delivering a tombstone piledriver, with Diesel going on to leave the company shortly after. When the Heartbreak Kid Shawn Michaels was forced to vacate his world championship in 1997, the belt was opened up to four contenders: Bret Hart, Stone Cold Steve Austin, Vader, and The Undertaker, the men facing off in a four-way elimination match which saw Bret Hart claim the title. The jubilation for Bret was short-lived, as we saw him drop the belt the very next night on Monday Night Raw to Psycho Sid. Then Bret Hart would focus his attention on Steve Austin and leave the number one contender spot open. At WrestleMania 13, Psycho Sid faced off against fellow former member of the Skyscrapers in WCW, The Undertaker. After a grueling 21-minute match with no clear victor in sight, Bret Hart uncharacteristically made way to interfere in the match. Undertaker, seizing the opportunity, delivered the Tombstone Piledriver and continued the streak, now 6-0. As 1997 continued to roll around, The Undertaker lost his WWF belt at SummerSlam to Bret Hart due to a supposed accidental interference from guest referee Shawn Michaels. Naturally, The Undertaker was furious and demanded a match to get revenge. In Your House Ground Zero, the two men faced off, but the match was declared a no contest. The animosity had come to a boil, and Undertaker vs. Shawn Michaels was scheduled for a fight inside a steel cage. However, due to the magnitude of the men involved, WWF needed to take it to the next level. With the inspiration coming from Jim Cornette, the Hell in a Cell structure was devised, and for the first time, we saw two men competing in this unforgiving space. During the match, long-term ally of The Undertaker, Paul Bearer, brought in Kane, a demonic figure who was calling himself Undertaker's brother. Kane was darker, scarier, taller, and more muscular than his older brother, and caused him to lose his match, handing Shawn Michaels the victory. At the Royal Rumble in 1998, during a casket match between Shawn Michaels and The Undertaker, Kane once again interjected into the event and cost his older brother another loss. There was nothing more for it. The Undertaker and Kane's rivalry had surpassed mere sporting spectacle and become increasingly personal. The two brothers, with a hidden past, would come face to face at WrestleMania 14. By this point, the newcomer Kane had truly been built up to be a monster in more ways than one, with his menacing attire and powerful entrance on top of his in-ring dominance. This was never more evident than when he managed to kick out of The Undertaker's tombstone as the referee counts for 1, 2. Kane's arm raised, his shoulder off the mat, and the crowd were in disbelief. How could a man withstand such punishment, unlike anyone had before him? Undertaker picks up the victory for his 7th consecutive WrestleMania win, but not before putting on a match which solidified Kane as a true contender in WWF with a bright future.
At the King of the Ring pay-per-view on June 28, 1998, at the Civic Center in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the most famous chokeslam happened and became a notorious wrestling moment that reverberated around the wider world. Mick Foley, known at the time as Mankind, was set to take on The Undertaker in the third ever Hell in a Cell match, a stipulation, still to this day, reserved for the most hate-filled rivalries. High above the ring, atop of the steel cage, which the two athletes had fought in and out of, known to be one tough son of a bitch, and was determined not to let this turn of events lose him the match, he returned to fight after several minutes of medical attention, and somehow ended back up on top of the cage with The Undertaker. Foley, bloody and broken, tried to stand his ground, but was too weak to avoid further attacks. When Undertaker grabbed Foley by the neck and pulled him into the air, Foley was ready to receive the famous Undertaker chokeslam. The fans cheered, gasps filled the arena as Foley was slammed hard into the roof of the cell. However, the strength of the cage's roof wasn't tested, and to the shock of the crowd, the announcers, and even Undertaker himself, Foley crashed hard through the cell ceiling and fell 20 feet to the ring below. Mick Foley crashed to the mat and his lifeless body slumped in the middle of the ring, unconscious. The fans in the stadium had witnessed one of the scariest and most devastating moments in pro wrestling history, and certainly the most famous chokeslam. Journalist Michael Landsberg called it maybe the most famous match ever, for which both men received a very extended standing ovation from the crowd in attendance that night. Terry Funk, famed hardcore legend, wrote in his autobiography, "Watching from the back, I thought he was dead. I ran out here and I looked down at him, still lying in the ring where he'd landed. His eyes weren't rolled back in the back of his head, but they looked totally glazed over, like a dead fish's eyes." The 27-minute match is bloody, gruesome, and at times hard to watch, but nonetheless, one of the most influential in wrestling's history, cementing the chokeslam as one of the most iconic moves ever performed in the squared circle.
The Undertaker began to slide deeper into madness, across further to the dark side by the middle of 1998, when he formed the Ministry of Darkness and would have the full support of the group as he once again began the journey to regain the WWF belt. At this time, The Undertaker drew opposition from the corporation, who controlled most of the decisions in the company. In order to try and bring down this powerful foe, The Undertaker would challenge the big boss man, a bodyguard of sorts for the corporation, to a Hell in a Cell match, the very first to take place at the biggest show of the year. The match itself was typical of the time, with less focus on grappling and holds, and more about the character work. The standout moment occurred when, after delivering a brutal tombstone pile driver to the big boss man, The Undertaker pinned him before attaching his lifeless body to a noose with the help of his Ministry of Darkness, with fans in attendance horrified at the sight of the boss man's body hanging above the ring, something which WWE has retroactively removed from lots of their online versions of the event with. Whenever people would ask what the BSK was, I would say, if I told you, I'd have to kill you. On screen, The Undertaker has been part of many different teams and factions over the course of his illustrious career, from tag team partnerships with his kayfabe brother Kane, to his leading role as the head of the Ministry of Darkness, and even aligning with the McMahons to create the supergroup, the Corporate Ministry. Behind the scenes, however, The Undertaker led a different kind of faction. Born out of the need to stop the overwhelming domination in the locker room brought by the rival group, The Click. Throughout the mid-90s, The Click had assumed a lot of control over the creative storylines and how matches were won. With Shawn Michaels, Kevin Nash, Triple H, Scott Hall and Sean Waltman banding together to give themselves more negotiating power. Other wrestlers in the locker room felt pressured by The Click and decided that they couldn't continue to run unopposed. In 1993, The Undertaker, a man who had demanded respect amongst his peers since the early days of his career, pulled his closest allies in the business even closer, and through a love of playing dominoes with one of the oddest combinations of WWF wrestlers you'll ever likely see, BSK was born. To understand deeper about the formation of this mysterious collaboration, I want to dive into some quotes from the men who were there at the time, riding on the road, and see what they have to say. Everybody thinks that The Undertaker started the BSK, but it was actually Yoko. Yoko was always the mouthpiece at the time. It stood for the Bone Street Crew: myself, The Undertaker, Yokozuna, Rikishi, Savio Vega, Brian Adams, Paul Bearer, and Papa Shango. Then Midian came up a year later and joined too. Me and The Undertaker were friends before. I didn't know any of the other guys except from what I saw them on TV. I met them all in WWE. We were just a bunch of guys with similar personalities. When I arrived to the group, they had been there for a year or two, and knowing Yokozuna and Rikishi, I was accepted. I worked against The Undertaker one night on Monday Night Raw. We beat the stuff out of each other. After that night, he took me under his wing. I started riding with Paul Bearer and him. Then my partner came up, and me, him, Paul and Taker were together all the time. I was already friends with a lot of the guys. I was the last inductee into the BSK. You had to have Undertaker and Yokozuna discuss if you could be in. No pressure. Fuji was with us too. We called him Uncle. These men banded together not only for functional reasons. I mean, they travelled together, lodged together, ate together, everything. The men who were drawn together because of business soon realised that they had a lot more in common. As they sat discussing their last matches and how each of them could improve over a beer or ten, the men created a lasting bond which all of them talk of fondly to this day. The age-old tabletop game of dominoes can trace its lineage back to the earliest games that humans ever played, with something created for the pure reasoning of entertainment and fun. The domino pieces were originally simple stones with scratch symbols to indicate different values of each rock. As the game evolved and mankind's ability to create became more sophisticated, people began to carve animal bones into pieces which resemble an early form of the modern day domino. The rich elite were afforded more luxurious forms of the early domino game, with fine stones being inlaid with pieces of animal bone and ivory from tusks. This is where we derive the modern day term for dominoes, bones. Apart from their shared passion for the wrestling business, the members of BSK and WWF shared other hobbies, the main one being playing dominoes into the early hours of the morning on long journeys and often accompanied by a swig or two of Jack Daniels. We were a bunch of guys that hung out together, rode together, listening to the same type of music, did the same things at night, and we played dominoes. Yoko would talk like a gangster. One time he said, "BSK, Bone Street Crew in the house." That was Yoko starting it. Like any sane group of 30 to 50 year old work colleagues would do, and in one of the most pro wrestling-y things ever, the members of the Bone Street Crew went out and got tattoos, marking their lifelong allegiance to the group. Much like the clique, they were just guys who hung out with each other. At some point, after guys had stirred up the locker room about the clique, all of those guys got BSK tattoos. I got interested in tattoos. On the right arm, I have a couple of things, like a spider and a web. I said to the guys, "On this side, I want you to put BSK. I arrived at the arena and I said, "Okay, I got my tattoo. I want to see more." I was like, "Man, we've all got to get these tattoos. We've all had tattoos anyway. I have this demon on my back. He's got really big hands and across his knuckles it says BSK. It's really cool." You had to come up with your own thing. Mine is on the leg and it's in a design that says BSK. I got two. I got a dagger on my arm. A couple of years later, I got the letters on my neck. Obviously, The Undertaker has the biggest one. He always takes his singlet off at the end of a match, and when he does, bam, there's the tattoo. Undertaker got it tattooed on his belly big time. Yoko said he was going to have a small one on his arm. Rikishi never did, but I was the first one to have the BSK tattooed on me. Everyone has their own valid opinions about tattoos and this kind of male bonding in the fraternity sense. Members of the rival group The Clique especially Triple H, have been pretty outspoken about their opposition to the idea of these kind of tattoos, even going as far as to call it embarrassing. But it's of nobody's business but those in the BSK who decided all those years ago to sear these iconic letters into their skin forever. It's funny, it was so long ago. I talked to Rikishi a couple of days ago and it seemed like everybody has a different feel for what BSK was. As of 2020, 5 members of the BSK have been selected for a place in the WWE Hall of Fame. Mr. Fuji, Yokozuna, Paul Bearer, Rikishi and The Godfather all taking their rightful place amongst this legendary record of the industry's greatest performers. Surely it's only a matter of time before the number becomes 6 with the induction of The Undertaker. The guarded nature of the BSK members and their unwillingness to allow insiders into their business means that as we look back into wrestling history, this ragtag group of men perhaps don't stand out as much as the Clique or the Stampede guys like the Hearts. The rest of the locker room never found out what it meant. You're not going to ask because they're not going to tell you. Nobody was willing to ask. But their simple existence meant that they were able to put a limit on the powers of others within the pro wrestling industry, for better or for worse. Either way, behind the scenes, the BSK had a huge impact on the whole of pro wrestling. The Undertaker took some much deserved time off in 1999 to rest an injury and took the time to completely reinvent his character for the new millennium. When The Undertaker returned in 2000, he was no longer the bringer of death. The American badass Taker was born and immediately went back to where he had left off, taking on the evils in the company which he deemed unjust. Specifically, boss Vince McMahon, his daughter Stephanie, and her husband Triple H. As the McMahon-Helmsley faction was rightfully scared and also were in control of who faced off against who in matches, the likelihood of any of them openly fighting newly reinvigorated badass Taker was slim. This forced Taker, now paired with his younger brother Kane, to hold the boss's daughter hostage and threatened to throw her down the stairs if they were not granted their desired matches at the upcoming WrestleMania. In what turned out to be the biggest and most iconic WrestleMania of all time, The Undertaker faced off against Triple H and saw the pair's hatred spill out of the ring and fight around the arena. As they fought their way back into the ring, The Undertaker delivered a powerbomb finisher known then as The Last Ride and picked up his first victory at WrestleMania against Triple H. No one man personifies the idea of a time capsule more than Limp Bizkit's frontman, Fred Durst. Even if you just look at a picture of the bad motherfucker from Jackson Beale, you can smell the early 2000s seeping out from every pixel. The backwards cap covering his dyed blonde tips, his over-the-top blingy necklace lead your eyes towards his stereotypical tattoo sleeves down to his constantly flipped middle finger. Even in the modern day, as Fred Durst continues to flip the bird and appear sporadically in crowds at WWE shows, nothing much has changed since Limp Bizkit's short-lived run at the top of the pop charts 20 years ago. Someone who has changed dramatically in that time is WWE's Undertaker, a man who, during a character transition, adopted Limp Bizkit's Rollin' as his entrance theme, cementing his change from the dark side to the ginger-haired, sporting, motorbike-riding, American badass Undertaker. Fred Durst was seemingly delighted to have his band's music featured regularly alongside one of pro wrestling's most iconic stars. However, there was a caveat added when it came to signing the contract that would give WWE the rights to use the song. Fred Durst insisted that he appear in WWE's upcoming video game, SmackDown Just Bring It. Not wanting to miss the opportunity to feature a culturally popular song in their wrestling shows, to his delight, WWE agreed, and miraculously, Fred Durst appeared in the game as an unlockable character. Fred Durst became playable after successfully beating 15 enemies in Slobber Knocker mode, as fittingly, The Undertaker, a mission which proved tricky to complete, especially for me as a young chubby boy. Meaning that WWE had adhered to their agreement with Durst without having to make him a focal point of their much anticipated video game. All parties were pleased, especially when, in the final build of the game, the developers at THQ put in extra effort to create a full entrance for Fred Durst, but also a tag team featuring the singer and The Undertaker. Fred Durst appeared for a second time in a WWE game a year later as an unlockable character once again in WWF's Raw for Xbox. If you think the idea of Limp Bizkit's frontman featuring in a match where he could theoretically defeat Stone Cold Steve Austin is strange, then I must inform you, as is the case with most things pro wrestling related, it only gets weirder from here. Another case of a feud starting because of interference for Mark Calaway saw Ric Flair getting stuck into The Undertaker's match against The Rock at No Way Out in 2002. This led to a match at WrestleMania 18 between The Nature Boy and The Undertaker in a no disqualification match, which ended with a signature tombstone piledriver and both men covered in blood. After the match, Undertaker raised all 10 fingers to indicate for the first time that he was undefeated and thus began the acknowledgement of the streak. A storyline injury caused by The Big Show saw The Undertaker off our screens at the end of 2002, allowing for anticipation to build surrounding his return at the Royal Rumble early in 2003, where he set straight to work in confronting the man who had sidelined him. This led to a submission match between the two men at No Way Out, seemingly becoming the norm for The Undertaker leading up to a WrestleMania season. After Taker's victory, he was interrupted by A-Train, who saw to align with The Big Show in taking down The Undertaker. For some unknown reason, Nathan Jones, a bit part actor and even less of a bit part wrestler, came to The Undertaker's aid and helped fend off the two attackers. This led to The Undertaker's first tag team match at WrestleMania being scheduled, seeing him pair with Nathan Jones to take on Big Show and A-Train. However, before the match could start, Jones was attacked backstage and left unable to compete. The Undertaker took on both men in a hybrid of sorts between his demonic undead Undertaker and the Sons of Anarchy bite gang leader Taker. Although short-lived as a focus of The Undertaker's character, the Big Evil name would stick and remain as a common nickname for Mark Calaway throughout the rest of his career. It's so simple and descriptive, fitting for The Undertaker, who in his size is undeniably big and in his demonic actions, undeniably evil. By the time of Survivor Series 2003, Big Evil was taking on the boss once again in a historic buried alive match against Vince McMahon. I know what you're thinking, this one's in the bag for The Undertaker. The Undertaker, that's his job, burying people, but no. Surprise, surprise, there was interference in one of The Undertaker's matches leading to a feud going into WrestleMania. When The Undertaker's brother Kane caused him the match against Vince McMahon and buried Big Evil, the character died with it. Later, Kane would be haunted by audio in the arena, lighting malfunctions and the inevitable challenge from his older sibling, this time resurrected as the Dead Man. The Undertaker would defeat Kane with a tombstone piledriver at WrestleMania 20 in 2004, for his 12th consecutive victory in Madison Square Garden, New York. At WrestleMania 21 in 2005, the feeling of The Undertaker's streak had begun to rear into the forefront as Randy Orton challenged the Dead Man to a battle at the biggest event of the year, expressing his intentions to be the one to end the run. This is the first time that The Undertaker's feud going into WrestleMania would be built around the idea of protecting his streak. Randy Orton had been quickly rising through the ranks and taking out various legends on his path of destruction in order to gain the attention of The Undertaker and earn a match at WrestleMania. Randy's attention turned to The Undertaker's girlfriend Stacy Keibler and long-term ally Jake the Snake Roberts. On March 3, 2006, The Undertaker was deep into a World Heavyweight Championship match with then-champion Kurt Angle. As it was so close to WrestleMania, WWE couldn't possibly resist having the match interrupted. This year's interruptee was none other than Sexual Chocolate, the world's strongest man, Mark Henry, who cost Undertaker the match and his chance at the belt. In retaliation, as always, The Undertaker did what he does best and defeated Mark Henry at WrestleMania 22 by laying him softly into a nice cushioned box, otherwise known in WWE as a casket match victory. The Undertaker's 14th victory was an unremarkable one, with the story and the match itself being fairly forgettable for most. Nonetheless, the legacy of The Undertaker continued to grow through the rest of 2006. Due to the fact that when the 2007 Royal Rumble took place, there were three potential championships for the winner to choose from, gave The Undertaker, after winning the match, his pick from Batista, who was the SmackDown World Heavyweight Champion, Bobby Lashley, who was the current ECW Champion, and John Cena, who held the WWE Championship. The Undertaker, proving himself to be a true blue, chose to contend the SmackDown belt with Batista, and their match was set for WrestleMania 23 in April of 2007. The two men faced off in a hard-fought battle, which saw both kicking out of each other's powerful finishers, to the shock of the crowd in attendance and myself at home. After slogging it out through Batista bombs and chokeslams, The Undertaker countered a second powerbomb attempt by Batista and delivered a tombstone piledriver for the 1-2-3 and the World Heavyweight Championship. The Undertaker would go on to retain his title against Batista inside of a steel cage. The Undertaker lay there. Upon his return, he entered straight back into the world title scene, which consisted at the time of Batista and Edge, leading to a triple threat between the men at Armageddon in 2007, which Edge would win to take home the belt. When the Elimination Chamber match rolled around that year, The Undertaker was victorious in the SmackDown match and earned a shot against Edge at WrestleMania 24. The story this year, slightly different, with higher stakes for both men than we'd seen from any of The Undertaker's previous WrestleMania feuds. Not only was The Undertaker now set to defend a 15-match undefeated streak against Edge, who had also never lost a match at WrestleMania to that point, but also, now, the heavyweight championship was on the line. The magnitude of the event was matched in the ring by the two men in their prime, as The Undertaker began to run through his arsenal of classic moves, which he'd been successful with time and time again. Edge seemingly had a counter for it all. It was clear that The Undertaker would have to try something else. As the hard-fought battle drew to its conclusion, Edge attempted a spear, only to be caught in a Hell's Gate submission by The Undertaker. As Edge tapped out, The Undertaker ended the night with it all. His undefeated streak was now standing at 16, and for the second year in a row, he had won the World Heavyweight belt on the biggest stage in WWE. But before we move on, let's take a deeper look at the Hell's Gate submission. Arguably the most important man to have ever laced his wrestling boots and stepped into the squared circle, The Undertaker's moveset is every part as iconic as his long leather coat or the lightning, which he seemingly has some sort of ethereal control over. If he wasn't dropping his foes on their heads or flying off the top rope to deliver a ferocious chop, you'd often find The Undertaker attempting, and often succeeding, to win matches with his version of the go-go platter submission. Nothing The Undertaker ever did in his career could be considered ordinary. He is a half-giant, half-undead zombie, half-wizard, half-gravekeeper man after all. Pro Wrestling Wiki states, "The move is performed by a wrestler putting their right shin on their opponent's throat and both palms of their hands on the back of their head, laying back and squeezing to draw the air from the opponent with the intention to force them to tap out or pass out." When it was first introduced into WWE on SmackDown in January 2008, The Undertaker would use the move on his unwitting opponents. It proved so powerful that it caused them to cough up blood before losing consciousness. This was seemingly too much for then SmackDown General Manager Vicky Guerrero, who banned the move from being used on her show. The Undertaker, being the badass that he is, decided to continue to use the move in defense of his World Heavyweight Championship. When The Undertaker faced off with fan favorite CM Punk at the Breaking Point pay-per-view, Theodore Long overruled the referee's decision when CM Punk lost to The Undertaker's submission, citing Vicky Guerrero's ban on the move as the reason why. "The fans and me at home, at this point we were losing our minds, it seemed so unfair." And this is where The Undertaker, and WWE to be fair, as a company, excels. By banning the move, it draws controversy, and by extension, attention to it. Entertainment fans want to see banned films, they sometimes become cult classics, especially in the era before the internet, and wrestling's no different. And for this move, it worked. By the time The Undertaker added the move into his full-time arsenal in 2009, with the new name Hell's Gate perfectly fitting his character, the move was already cemented in pro wrestling folklore at SummerSlam in 2015, but not before Brock defiantly threw up his middle finger. Other wrestlers may go on to perform the submission in honor of The Undertaker, as no doubt most who enter into the wrestling business today will be influenced by this great man in one way or another. That being said, the Hell's Gate is in an elite group of moves which will be rightfully synonymous with just one man, The Undertaker. Now, back to the streak. In March of 2009, Shawn Michaels challenged The Undertaker to a match at WrestleMania 25, a fitting tribute to 25 years of WrestleMania history to have two men who had been a part of so many of the iconic moments over the previous quarter century. Leading up to the event, the spectacle was built around the core idea of history and legacy. As the two men stood face to face in the ring in the state of Texas where they grew up, in front of all those thousands of fans in the Reliance Stadium in Houston, still, nobody could have known what we were about to witness. Possibly the greatest WrestleMania match of all time. The bout between Shawn Michaels and The Undertaker saw both men delivering every move in their arsenal, but still coming up short of victory. The half-hour epic was as emotionally draining as it was physically, with the world witnessing two master artists performing through moments they had both spent their entire careers building towards. Reversal after reversal, two count followed by false finish, a near tap out here and a rope break there. By the time Shawn Michaels climbed to the top rope and attempted a moonsault flip, it seemed as if both men had almost all run out of ideas. As The Undertaker caught Michaels in midair, the fans knew this had to be it. Undertaker delivered his now iconic tombstone piledriver and won his 17th victory in a row at WrestleMania. The story leading to the next year's WrestleMania at WrestleMania 26 was one of redemption for Shawn Michaels, who wanted to amend his loss for the previous year and defeat The Undertaker and his streak. The only problem for Shawn was that The Undertaker simply wasn't interested and felt the matter had already been settled. This called for drastic action to get The Undertaker's attention, who was now the World Heavyweight Champion. At Elimination Chamber in 2010, Shawn Michaels took a leaf from The Undertaker's playbook and appeared from beneath the ring. He quickly struck The Undertaker with a sweet chin music superkick and afforded the challenger Chris Jericho the pin and the belt. The Undertaker now laser focused on the destruction of Shawn Michaels as a wrestler and his legacy once again, agreed to fight at WrestleMania 26 with an extra stipulation. Streak versus career. As the night came in 2010, the feeling from the year prior had returned. This time, the outcome was even less certain. Surely, The Undertaker cannot lose at WrestleMania. At this point, it's one of the key focuses of the entire show, and it's built up for months. The streak is WrestleMania by the time 26 is here. But on the other hand, Shawn Michaels, Mr. WrestleMania, arguably one of the greatest WWE performers of all time. Both men live in legends, but at WrestleMania 26, one of those legends had to die. The story of the match was different this time. The Undertaker had gained the upper hand when Shawn dived from the top rope out to the announce table and seemingly incurred huge damages, leaving Undertaker at 18-0. The history between Triple H and The Undertaker was one that had stretched through most of these men's careers, thus making the build to the match feel even more personal and organic than it had been in many years prior. Two older veterans, in-ring generals and masters of the art of pro wrestling, The Undertaker and Triple H told an intriguing story during their match of being past their primes, but never wanting to go out on their back, always ready for that one last fight. And his number rose to 19 consecutive victories. For many, the state that The Undertaker was in after the match, he needed aid just to make the journey. A Hell in a Cell match between Triple H and Undertaker at WrestleMania 28, with Shawn Michaels as the guest referee. This concoction of sublime pro wrestling ingredients led to one of the most interesting stories within a match that I've ever seen. The emotional journey that all three men go through on this night is remarkable. The Undertaker wants to regain his pride after what he felt was a poor showing the previous year, even if he did win. Triple H wanted revenge for his loss to the Deadman, and Shawn Michaels, coming out of retirement to get in the ring as the referee, firmly caught in the middle between there are far too many great moments to recall right now, but by the end, as The Undertaker delivered a tombstone pile driver and Shawn Michaels counted to three, all three men could stand tall. For even though the winner of the match and his consecutive 20th victory at WrestleMania was The Undertaker, all three men had been a part of one of the greatest matches in WWE history and deservedly would go on to be known as the end of the era. CM Punk was selected as The Undertaker's 21st opponent at WrestleMania 29, a story which built around the disrespect shown by CM Punk and his manager Paul Heyman in the lead up to the big match. Following the death of Paul Bearer, Paul Heyman dressed up as The Undertaker's recently deceased friend and made his way to the ring to mock The Undertaker, accompanied by the classic smoky druids of the years past. Such a disrespectful move drew the attention of more than just The Undertaker, as many felt offended by the WWE's use of such a recent real-life tragedy. Either way, as CM Punk revealed himself to be one of the druids in attendance, he raised an urn said to contain the ashes of the recently cremated bearer and poured them out onto The Undertaker. These actions blew up a storm of anger which saw CM Punk face off against the dead man in New Jersey in 2013. During the match at WrestleMania 29, CM Punk once again produced the urn and repeatedly attacked The Undertaker with it, in a battle which turned personal and nasty before the bell had even rung. In the end, The Undertaker was able to achieve a reversal from CM Punk's deadly go-to-sleep knee, turning it swiftly into a tombstone piledriver for the achievement of 21 victories in a row at WrestleMania. 21. Let that sink in. 21 is a number which will stand as a marker of The Undertaker's unmatched history within the world of pro wrestling. No one will ever be able to beat this achievement. Nobody ever even deserves to. In a career which perhaps did not see The Undertaker adorned in the gold of championship belts as much as others with his level of continued success, the 21-win undefeated streak devised by WWE is this right here. In 2010, Brock Lesnar was the UFC heavyweight champion, defending in a match which he lost to Cain Velasquez. After his defeat, as he made his way through the crowd, he was confronted by Mark Calaway with a short sentence which would ignite the spark that would eventually burn down The Undertaker's undefeated streak. At this time, The Undertaker had taken a 10-month hiatus from WWE. He had been utterly destroyed by the dominant Shield faction and sent home after being powerbombed through a table. When Brock Lesnar returned to WWE, it was clear that he and his newly realigned manager Paul Heyman were only focused on one goal: eat, sleep, conquer the streak. The terrifying prospect of being hunted by such an apex predator, Brock Lesnar wanted to dismantle the story of The Undertaker by inserting himself as a 1 in 21-1. Paul Heyman did the best work of his career on the mic in the lead up to the match as the mouthpiece for his client Brock Lesnar, explaining each week exactly what was going to happen to The Undertaker at the hands of the Beast. Heyman told us it was a spoiler that Brock would win and not a prediction, but even then, I didn't believe him. By the time WrestleMania 30 had drawn to a close, the whole world would have to believe. A moment which many thought impossible, beyond reason and beyond logic. Brock Lesnar got into the ring and he systematically took apart The Undertaker. Hard punches to the jaw left the dead man limp. German suplexes threw the giant around the ring like a child. Brock sweated and grew even more red as his anger surged through his blood. He was unrelenting and unwavering in his control over The Undertaker. The look in the dead man's eyes filled with sadness as the consciousness seemed to flicker back and forth. The old man seemed just that, as he was out of his depth and out on his feet. Brock delivered three F5s and there was no retort, no last minute reprieve from The Undertaker. 1, 2, 3. For the first time in the history of The Undertaker's WrestleMania career, they were not the sound of his victory. And as tears and gasps escaped from the millions of wrestling fans around the world, even Paul Heyman and Brock Lesnar themselves could not believe what had just happened. A legacy of a quarter century ended in an instant, and a quiet fell in the arena as we witnessed the death of the streak, 21-1. Now that's a story. We'll be right back.